Moving on to our next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together and welcome Dr. Fatima on board. Dr. Fatima is an academic consultant and education specialist for private sectors at the Ministry of Education and Higher Education in Qatar, a holder of PhD from the University of Oxford with 20 years of experience in the field of education, both academic and in field, worked at Qatar University and Qatar Foundation. Ladies and gentlemen, she has presented many workshops in reading, teachings, strategies, L1 and L2.
Hello, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. And thank you for our host for asking me to speak on this special session. Now, my presentation will be about how technology is fast forwarding our educational system, especially in these times. Now, as said by our beautiful host, that I'm a consultant at the private sector at the Ministry of Education and Higher Education, which means that my job is to give research informed to inform decision makers in the area of research. Spring 2020 witnessed school closures at short notice and created severe disruption of education. We saw head teachers that had to mobilize staff almost immediately to teach remotely with little preparation and very little training. And that impacted public education, private education, as well as higher education. And it was a real-time test of all the skills gathered up to that point and how we can cope and be creative. So the whole education system in Qatar was reimagined almost immediately, opting for a blended education model. Where students were put in bubbles for safety. So what could be said about that experience, that skills to respond to such a pandemic were never part of the educational caliber of student, staff, head teachers, or teachers themselves, which brings us to coping with this disruption. There were a lot of hurdles, to say the least, about this pandemic. As I said, remote education was established, shifting teaching processes online on whatever platform was available to schools, especially private schools. So the schools that had platformed prior to the pandemic shifted to those. Schools that didn't have any electronic or digital platforms had to cope with the change. Another hurdle or an important aspect of remote learning is the online assessment. Schools had to start online assessments on, as we can say, a trial and error basis, because it was not tested before. It wasn't widely spread or used by teachers. Pen and paper assessment was the assessment of choice prior to the pandemic. And the other, in my opinion, most challenging part of the digital learning was content creation, because online education does not just mean switching from real life to screen education. Teachers have to and are still facing the challenge of creating content that is suitable for remote education, which could be engaging, can transcend the obstacle of having the student in real life classrooms. So new school systems and the new tools that the school had in the new context was that student had to have internet access, virtual virtual classrooms. Students had to use emails, even as young as 6 or 7 year olds had to check with their emails, even with the parents, probably using learning devices, computers, tablets, iPhones, smartphones has become a norm. The platforms, as I said, now is an integral part of education, whereas in the past it was something additional, luxurious maybe for some schools, but not all schools. And then there is the learning packs, which might include downloaded and, you know, printed materials. Now, the concern for most of policymakers was that fears that remote learning would widen the attainment gap between children from different backgrounds. Now, prior to the pandemic, educators have always been advocating for change and progression in how schools, are organized. And conducted. There was always a need for a change of the education system that was forged in the 18th century. It was time for a paradigm shift, no matter how overwhelming it was and how overwhelming it continues to be. Because research shows that 65% of children in primary schools today will work in jobs that don't exist yet. There is also a correlation between higher education. The correlation between higher education and job performance is very low. Intelligence is becoming a better predictor of job performance. There is also a gap between what students learn in higher education and what they need to perform in jobs. So, as I said, all of the research prior to the pandemic was pointing towards a paradigm shift, a need for a paradigm shift. Now, a year into the pandemic, we are still learning a lot. Never before the world experienced remote education of the scale and scope. Literature is emerging, which is very exciting. It has two main strands, in my opinion. Either evidence documenting the positive impact of the forced change and the widening of the gap in access to remote learning. And most of all, the research is indicating how public schools and, you know, schools in its old format has now is being more appreciated, that parents had to deal with children education firsthand. Now, we all know the saying about how crises are blessings in disguise. So, as I said, the conversation about reimagining and reinventing school systems in the digital era has been going on for a while. If you type in the word reimagine education in any search engine and to look at the literature, you find that this conversation has been going on since the 1990s. It's not new. So the pandemic meant that institutions had to implement new strategies to keep the learning going. And as we all know, as educators, and the education sector have always been trying to devise the most effective reform strategies. So in my opinion, the pandemic and the lockdown and remote learning was a golden chance for pushing forward such a shift in the paradigm. Now, one report by McKinsey company was presented, school systems should recommit to 4 basic principles and consider 8 ideas within these principles for innovation, declaring what schools need to do to get through the disruption and move forward. And they include core skills and instruction, high quality teachers, data for performance, and context of performance. And these are the things that the schools would do normally, whether in a lockdown situation or a normal situation. And on the other hand, you have the elements that schools need to reimagine using technology for access, among other things. Now, so the way forward, in my opinion, based on this and many other articles, is that schools need to recommit to what works. We know a lot from decades of research and education about children learning, how they master literacy and numeracy, for example. You can't code if you can't do math, and you cannot communicate effectively if you can't read, and children cannot innovate without knowledge. So going back to the basics is the number one rule for remote education in any situation. And then harnessing the technology is the second part of this of the way for of the roadmap, if we can call it, and that would include many things. Now, when it comes to technology, we also know that it needs to be harnessed. You can't just hand in devices to improve learning, and video lecturing can never replace face-to-face interaction. So the challenge is to incorporate technology to improve quality and access. Now, mastery-based learning is also another way forward, including individualized plans. Individualized plans or learning used to be utilized by the elite, but technology made it possible with the use of automated pacing apps that integrate instruction, practice, and feedbacks, which are accessible to many. We see many apps that help or encourage the practice of math, languages, etc. So students can work on their own pace and free some time for the teachers to do other planning and creative tasks. Now, the balance between screen and non-screen activities is another challenge for teachers to provide content for learners. And it's an important aspect, as technology should not be overused. A third or a fourth aspect of talking about technology and the way forward is a main area that should not be omitted in any conversation now, supporting the child holistically. Students with high self-motivation thrived, while others have struggled, and this has been documented in the research. The shift, how are we doing on time? So the shift to remote learning also had its emotional toll. The pandemic raised awareness of the need to address anxiety, mental wellness, among other issues such as depression, which were amplified during the pandemic. Schools are encouraged now to incorporate character education and mindful thinking tools. Now, so the third element, or I think it's the fourth element, is thinking about school structures and school policies as a whole. As I said earlier, schools now have an opportunity to rethink the school system as it was forced in the 18th century. For example, a school calendar around the long summer vacation might not be the ideal option for students who are struggling with remote learning. We can see reports in Australia, for example, have already rearranged their school calendar. Schools might as well think about reorganizing the summer schools. Some schools in Canada are scraping grade levels completely, opting for proficiency in its curriculum scale. So systems that rely heavily on grade repetition, for example, should rethink their structure as well. Now, the opportunity for change within the school system is now, it's within reach. Schools should explore secure systems for assessment at home. There is the idea of exploring with different timing in school models. And we know that at the beginning of the pandemic, some schools, the classes were recorded and students can listen and tune in the videos at their own convenience when the parents are around. Empowering teachers to make the most of the digital advances and providing training opportunities. And then the last idea would be using the variation within countries, looking other you know, outside the country boundaries to see how other countries are coping and dealing with remote learning. Now, I would like to finish with this main idea that educational digital tools, supply and demand relationship should be inverted. And what I mean by this is that it's time for the educational institutes to initiate their needs rather than IT companies offering their ready-made tools. Because instead of companies coming to educational institutes and saying, these are the products that we have, you can use this and this and this, I think it's time now for the educational institutes to say, this is what we're doing. These are the needs that we have. Can you devise digital tools for such and such? And leaving you with this idea, thank you for listening to my short presentation. And thank you for our host again. I think the floor should be open for questions. Okay. What is the traditional? Unique and go beyond what is traditional taught in schools. What are the current challenges school system facing in terms of switching between technologies and upgrading? I think that brings us to the same question that I presented in the last slide. Now, educational systems have a duty towards the child, towards the commitment they make for parents. And although there are technological advances that are happening as we speak, the main priority is not to catch up with these, just to catch up with technological advances and upgrading, but to think about a complete school system that would teach the child, individual of the future, how to cope with the technological upgrading, with himself as an individual, with himself as a part of society, how to utilize these tools, whether they know about these specific tools or others, because you know what is an upgrade now would be obsolete in 2-3 years, if not months. So schools have a duty to focus on the child holistically, on literacy, on creative skills, on critical skills, on becoming a member of the society. And technology is only one aspect of that. And educators should not lose sight of this fact. Another question is, do you see these differences? Let me read this one. The ensuing economic disruption raises important issues about the future relationship between education and technology. The prospect of widespread technological unemployment highlights a different relationship between education and technology. Do you see these differences dropping in the near future? Well, whatever is happening in that aspect, I don't think it is dropping. I think it might be even be amplified, but I'm still saying we should concentrate on the priorities for why education exists in the first place. What are the key things school systems should do for that difference to the drop? I mean, of course, the economic disruption that happened in many parts of the countries due to the lockdown did affect education, especially in more in financially challenged families. So as I said, the research in this area does point out that the technology gap is widening, and it has been advised that governments should take into its hand to try and provide access for education, economical support in some countries. I know in Qatar, there was a lot that has been done through Qatar Investment Bank to support businesses. And so I'm speaking about us locally. And I've also looked at the UNESCO reports and reports globally about the need for such support as to lessen the gap between, you know, poorer children and children from other backgrounds. I don't see any more questions here. So again, please post your questions in the chat box if you have any more. And thank you for the team for organizing this forum about educational and digital issues that are being discussed and are happening as we speak.
Thank you for sharing the insights. I am sure everybody is delighted to have you, and the insights are going to be helpful on a longer run. Thank you so much once again for being with us.